तत्सवितुर्वरेण्यं ओम भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि ओम धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात्। सो वंस अगेन नमस्ते टू एवरीवन एंड इट्स अ ग्रेट टाइम दैट वी आर कंडक्टिंग दिस वेबिनार ऑन द म्यूचुअल फंड्स एंड वी हैव विथ अस मिस मोनिका हलनवी। एंड द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट आई वुड लाइक टू टेल यू इज दैट मैम हैज बीन extremely appreciative of the women's education efforts which are being done at Banasthali Vidyapeeth. I trust many of you have attended the last webinar, and in the last webinar she had presented her views on personal finance, and which was followed by questions. We had put the recorded content on YouTube, and so many people have seen and appreciated the video, so we are highly thankful to Monica ma'am for helping us whenever we are in need. And dear students and the members of staff, you might be knowing that Monica ma'am now is a columnist at Bloomberg. And apart from that, she is the author of Let's Talk Money. Of course, you know about it because we are all studying. And I would like to tell you that now the Hindi version of the book has also come up, and it was my pleasure to receive a personal copy, and that copy was signed by ma'am, and she has conveyed the best wishes. So all of us at Banasthali congratulate her for the Hindi version of the book. And you are all aware about ma'am that she has been promoting the cause of women's education, personal finance over the time. And I would like to tell you one thing, that when I used to visit her Twitter profile earlier, there was a tagline, finance must serve households. And this line, I would tell you, dear students, took me a lot of time to understand what she means to say. But now I understand that, you know, from the supply side also, the regulators, etc., are equally responsible. So the world of finance in which we are the part of, I think of the finance has a social role to play as well. So I welcome Monica Halanji as the chief speaker to this webinar. And the flow of this webinar is that we have requested ma'am to present her views on how people can start investing in mutual funds. And once her talk is over, then our students have collected some questions from the students who have registered as participants, and we would be then requesting ma'am to answer those questions. So I request Ms. Monica Halanji to please address our bright students and staff members.
Thank you so much, Dr. Purohit. It's always a pleasure for me. The institutions like Banasthali will always have a place in my calendar. That is really a promise, and it's a delight whenever I see news about girls from Banasthali doing well, flying higher, you know, breaking the glass ceiling. It's like a personal win for me. So to each girl, each woman out there, your you know, the doors that you open remain open for all those behind you. So keep at it, don't stop, because once you open that door, there'll be others behind you who will use that door, and then they will open further doors down the line. We're going to talk about mutual funds, and the way that I thought we will use this 1 hour is I'll speak for about 30-35 minutes, and then I'm hoping really for more interactive, more questions. And I know that you're all students of personal finance, so I want to give you a perspective of the history, you know, this whole why mutual funds, how it came to be. There's so many stories, and once we understand those stories, we'll also realize the importance of this product category in the portfolio, and why personally I have been such an advocate for this product type, to say that this is what really suits retail investors, investors who want to move out of fixed deposits, gold, real estate, insurance. Where can they go? And the reasons you will see through the talk why I think this is one of it's a good product category for retail investors. I hope you can see the slides, everyone. The slides are visible.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, okay. So I want to give more of a historical context, and I'm sure, you know, your students of personal finance, you would have read a little bit about it, that till 91, India was a socialist economy. the government and the bureaucracy controlled the basic questions of economics: what to produce, how to produce, for whom to produce, at what price to produce, things which are left best to market forces. There was a group of people sitting in Delhi who would decide those things. So the state ran everything. It fixed interest rates, it fixed IPO prices. You had no option but to go to the state for basic services. So you had the nationalized public sector banks, and people of my generation still remember what those banks used to be like. You girls will probably never imagine banks the way that we have seen them. The fight to get your own money, the hours of waiting with a token, sitting while the bank officers were not interested in service because they had a pensionable job and no one could throw them out. In that controlled economy, you had a nationalized insurance company called Life Insurance Company. You had nationalized general insurance companies, and you had a monopoly called UTI, Unit Trust of India, which was the first mutual fund of India. And these are all monopolies, and they behaved like monopolies. So UTI is a monopoly for 25 years. It did well with it by investors. Initially, things went well, and a lot of investors did very well investing through mutual funds into the equity markets. I mean, that was mainly UTI was known for its equity investments. The other categories came much later, and we'll see how that happened. Remember, it's still socialist. 87, 91 has not yet happened, but the pressures towards opening up the market were there. There were a lot of talks within the Planning Commission. If you haven't read Montek Singh Ahluwalia's book on Backstage, you must, because you must know how even that 91 change happened. And what we have today is a continuum. We may want to believe that 2014 was the year in which reform began. It is a continuation and an escalation of the reform, but that really began two decades ago, 91. And before that, really the pressures had started in the 80s. So it's a continuum. And some of those books are very, very important for all of us to read to understand the continuity of what is happening today. So 87, there's pressure to allow more competition, and public sector mutual funds are allowed. So state-run banks, Canara Bank had one, State Bank had one, Bank of Baroda had one, LIC had one. So you allowed public sector entities to set up mutual funds because everyone thought private sector is bad, they run away with the money. And then 91 happened and you had liberalization. You opened up the economy. But we still have a controlled economy in finance. But in that year, 91, starting 91, 92, you had the Harshad Mehta scam. Some of you may have seen that series on, I think, Netflix or wherever. You understand what happened with that, how banking, a loophole in the banking laws was used to inflate stock market prices. So what Harshad Mehta got right, and I have to tell you this story, I was a rookie reporter. I had started my profession, my career, right out of Delhi School of Economics in 1991. At 23, I got my first job as a trainee researcher in Business Today magazine, which was starting out. I think I got a first check of 1,500 rupees as salary. And that was the year that the markets, I mean, this was that cusp year when that new industrial policy came out, and the entire market thought that India is going to be unleashed. And that was used by operators like Harshad Mehta to start inflating stock market prices. And when I joined the workplace, the Sensex was at, it had doubled just then in those few months. And from 1,000 something, it had become 2,000, Sensex 2,000. Okay, so today when I look back, and I think of Sensex 2000, and today at 50,000, my only thought is, what if I had had money at the start of my career, and what if I knew what I know now then, what would I have done then? All right. And then just moving out of this, every time the Sensex touched a threshold, of 10,000, 12,000, 20,000. Every time I have heard stories of saying it's going to crash, this is a scam. So what the journey which started at 2,000 and 50,000 is still going strong, and we are in the middle of second generation, very deep reform in India right now. In the last 12 months, what has happened is truly path-breaking. So it's a 91 moment for me again. And from 50,000 on, long-term, I see no problem. And that's related to what I'm going to talk about for mutual funds. So anyway, let's go back. So PSU mutual funds are set up. There's a stock market scam. And that is when you have regulation coming into the financial sector. So SEBI is set up. National Stock Exchange is set up, because Bombay Stock Exchange at that time was a den of thieves. And then reform happened with screen-based trading. Bombay Stock Exchange and all the other stock exchanges used to be open outcry. So the investor would never know at what price the deal actually happened. So you would buy at the highest price and you would sell at the lowest price. Then NSE, it was a transformation to do screen-based trading. Imagine a time when there's no internet. Okay, they used VSAT equipment and all that to link up. It's a different time, but they did it. And then the view was that you need a vehicle for retail investors to invest in the markets. Bond markets were still far away. The first thought was equity of the regulators. And 1993, the first rules were set up for mutual funds. And privatization was allowed in 93. Mm-hmm. And the first mutual fund was Kothari Pioneer, which of course got bought out. And I'm sure you know the story of who bought Templeton, bought out Pioneer. And but the first off the block was Kothari Pioneer. And then as more and more private sector participation happened, 96 came the regulation. This was the first formal regulation in the mutual fund space, where it was the three-tier structure was thought about. So remember, this is aftermath of a big stock market scam. Anyway, you're a socialist mindset. You don't trust the market. You don't trust the private sector. And that actually worked in favor of the mutual fund industry as a whole and retail investors in particular. Because the way that mutual funds were set up in India, it got a three-tier structure to protect the investors' money from being appropriated and to protect them from fraud. The money was held in a trust. So there was a three-tier structure. The sponsor is the business entity who wants to set up the fund. So for instance, today ICICI Bank will be the sponsor for ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. Or Mirae, the company in South Korea, will be the sponsor for Mirae Asset Management. So you'll have a sponsor with a business interest who wants to run the business and earn a profit. But the money is not held by the sponsor. Another entity is set up, which is called the trust. The trust rules globally are very, very strict. So the money is held by the trust in the name of the investor, so that nobody can run away with that money. The sponsor can't run away, and the asset management company. So when we talk about the mutual fund, it's really the AMC. The AMC is only a service provider to the sponsor, where the trustee company is the entity which tells the AMC how to behave, what to do, what not to do. The asset management company runs it for a fee. And we'll come to that. The expense ratio that we pays for the asset management company's fees, its profits. And a part of that profit, of course, goes to the sponsor as well. But the money is held in trust with the trustee in the name of the investor. And the rules, the trust rules in India are such that if fraud is proved, trustees can go to jail, their personal assets can be attached. So there is a big fear of not allowing fraud to happen. So you have to remember that bad fund management, sharp practices, and market volatility are different risks. But imagine a time if an AMC, a mutual fund, could collect the money and run away. It can't do that because then whoever the sponsor is will go to jail. Their personal houses, cars, everything can be attached. Those are the rules, which is why no mutual fund has run away with investors' money. We've heard of Hofland Finance, we've heard of CRB, we've heard of so many companies, company deposits. I mean, banks can fail, cooperative banks fail and money goes to zero. But have we ever heard of a mutual fund reducing the value of your money to zero or running away with the money? It cannot because of the structure of the industry. So the first protection for retail investors is built in against fraud. We'll come to how the regulators have dealt with other issues of conflicts of interest, expenses, bad fund management, all of that. But its foundation is such that you cannot run away with the money. Now, UTI stays out of the SEBI ambit. So mutual funds is it's a market entity and they are regulated by SEBI. But UTI takes the view that it's a monopoly, it's a government entity, there's an act of parliament, so it does not submit itself to SEBI regulations and it stays out. So all of these structures, all of the protections to investors, this whole disclosure of portfolio, disclosure of the net asset value, why is it so important? Because so you know every day what is happening in the portfolio. UTI takes the view that it doesn't need to do all this, it's government. And then there's a blowout on Unit 64. So you should ask your fathers and uncles. Most women stayed out of these conversations then. So you ask your elders in the house. And there will always be a story of how Unit 64 was bought with a lot of enthusiasm and how they that generation promised itself that it'll never invest in mutual funds because of what happened with Unit 64. It was a big blowout. 2003, UTI has to submit to SEBI, the bad assets are put into SUTI, it's an entity, you separated out the bad assets and UTI Mutual Fund then followed all the SEBI rules and became like any other mutual fund. From that time on, there has been a whole series of reforms and I'm going to go through them. But today, it's an industry with 32 trillion rupees in assets under management, that 32 with 12 zeros behind it. The insurance industry manages 35 trillion rupees. So it's an older industry, it's a different industry, but yet look at the difference in the gap between the assets under management. And the monthly SIP book today is 8,000 crore. So there is some argument on the numbers today, but that's the number I've got from AMFI. We're still trying to resolve whether it's 8,000 crore or it's 3,000 crore, but it's hit 8,000 crore a month of flows into equity. This is pure retail money. So these are all signs that when you do reform aimed at investors, investors come to the market, they come and trust the product. So we don't even remember this time, but when the 96 regulations came, and this is how the industry worked for almost a decade and a half, they were allowed entry and exit loads of 7%. All right, so if you are investing 100, 7 rupees could actually go as commission. It was embedded in the product, you would invest 100 and 93 would go to work. But the addition of the entry and the exit load could not be more than 7. So the industry itself did an industry standard of 2.5% of entry load. It isn't as if SEBI told them to do it, but the DNA of the industry when it started again was more retail oriented than say the insurance industry. So the industry standard became 2.25. So if you invested 100, then 97.75 would get invested. 2.25 would be the agent's commission embedded into the price of the product. And so there's an entry cost and the maintenance cost was on an average 2% a year. There was a sliding scale. And the new fund offer, so when a new fund was launched by an AMC, they were allowed to charge 6% of the amount collected for the marketing cost. So if the mutual fund is advertising, it's doing road shows, it's doing whatever, all of that was charged to the investors and you could amortize it over 5 years. So if a, and it was on the amount collected. So if a fund house collected 1,000 crores, what is 6% of that? 6 crore or 60 crore? What that number is the amount that the fund house could take out of the money collected and use as its costs. So now wherever there is money, there is going to be misuse of it. So this 60 crore. So 60 crore would be amortized over 5 years. So look at the incentive structure. So you want, then every fund house, so once everyone gets into the frenzy, you had 2004, 2005, you had hundreds of new fund offers because everyone was trying to collect this money. And then the distributors got into the story and they started appropriating that money from the AMC to say that you pay me this 6% and you pay me 2.25%. It was 8% upfront. And then they would start rotating people between one new fund offer and the other because people were not that financially literate. Markets were going up. They couldn't see what was happening. So the agents were taking away massive amounts of money. And both AMCs as well as investors were suffering. So they were taking away 8 crore and they were churning. So again, personal story, I was in Indian Express that time. I was a consulting editor there. And I found out about this. And you know, the power of data is so powerful. All I did is I put some numbers into an Excel sheet and showed how much money investors would make, how much AMC would make, and what is it that the distributors were making on some of the real numbers out of the new fund offers. And we also got data on the commissions being earned. And I remember we ran a page one story. And post that, we had reform. From then on, a series of reforms have started. And to SEBI's credit, they have always seen the industry with the view that investors need to benefit. And the reform which started with the Mr. Damodaran has just not stopped. I mean, there were gaps for a few years in the middle, but mostly it has been in investor interest. 2005, 2008, Mr. Damodaran takes the view that the 6% NFO charge is too high, and he takes it away from open-ended funds. It remained, you could still charge 6% on the closed-end funds. So there are two kinds of funds. I hope all of you know that they are open-ended, which simply don't have an exit date. You can exit when you want, but the fund continues. Closed-end funds have an exit date. They will shut, they will return investors' money. Now, to prevent this churning, SEBI said the NFO charge is not there. They removed it on closed end in 2008 because what the industry then did is they started to launch closed end funds. So look at the NFOs, March 06, number of NFOs, how regulation has gone on tightening the noose around the industry to behave better. So from March 06, I don't have data after that, but 42 NFOs. And as regulation is coming, you see the number of NFOs go down. The number of NFOs would have increased later because the industry expanded, new funds came in, but that 6% harvesting went away. When Mr. Damodaran took the candy away from closed, open-ended and gave it to closed-end, you see how the behavior of the industry changed. 2006, that door shut for open-ended, but remained open for closed-end. So see the number of closed-end schemes starting to increase, 24, from 10 to 24. And when that door shut for closed-end, the number of NFOs in closed-end also started coming down. So regulations impact the behavior of funds. And Dr. Purohit had said that finance must serve households. regulators need to understand that unless they put in place rules in investor interest, it is not free markets which is going to do it in finance. The regulators will have to dictate how finance will serve households. Then the story reaches another scale, and this is 2009. And again, it's a personal story. I was with the Government of India for a year. I was working on the Swaroop Committee report, and I had gone across to different regulators to discuss issues of investor protection and you know, how you can build safety into the products. And what Mr. Bhave said was that we have to ask the question, whose agent is he? Because there was still this commission in the product, because there is data to prove that agents will sell products with higher commissions. So even if there is if there's a commission in the product, it will not be the investor's interest, but the commission that any fund is giving you. So the agent is sitting there with a shop. Whose fund will he sell? Not the one which is good for you, but the one which is giving the agent the maximum commission. So Mr. Bhave asks the question, whose agent are you? Are you the agent of the investor, or are you the agent of the company? If you are the agent of the company, you get no investor money directly. You'll have to be compensated by the company, by the AMC. In 2009, 1st August, he made mutual funds a zero load product. Okay, so I was there. I was, in the sense, I have seen this upfront, this whole story playing out, and the shock to the industry was, everyone said the industry is going to die. Nobody can sell a financial product if there are no commissions in it. I remember meeting an insurance CEO on the airport once, when just after Mr. Bhave, and he was saying, you know what, you people have just killed the industry. Now only insurance will remain. I'm getting calls from mutual fund CEOs for jobs. Khatam hai, this industry is over. Why? Because you've taken commissions away. And you know, we were, the policy view was that incentives need to be aligned with investor interest. So if there's a trail commission or if it's fee-based, then the agent will sell the product, which is good for the investor, so that as the investor makes more money, the agent on a trail commission will make more trail. That was the view. And it was a theoretical policy view. And when 2009, we saw the industry tank, you know, we really fear that maybe what happens in theoretical exercises doesn't really work in the market. But the view was, it's finance. Why will people not follow the money and build products and sell things which work for people? And we knew that it is really a good product. Finally, mutual funds is the way the whole world's retail investor goes to market. So Mr. Bhave took a very bold step. He paid for it because he'd got no extension. He got into a fight with IRDA because he said, you know what, the ULIP is actually a mutual fund. And he was right, because 90% of the premium was towards a mutual fund. Only 10% of the premium or less was towards insurance. So that went badly. But what he did really was this. So this is from AMFI, and 2009 is this dip that you see in the assets under management. Okay, from this is rupees crore, 1, 2, 3. So from 5 trillion, it dropped to 4 trillion. And this is also the time of that, you know, 2008 crisis and all of that. When you're on that downswing, you don't know if there will be an upswing. But subsequently, what all of us have realized is that the DNA of an investor-friendly product, finally, it was understood, and the industry worked hard. The distributors turned themselves into advisors. So if you meet an insurance agent and a mutual fund IFA, you will immediately sense the knowledge difference between the two. The insurance agent just wants to make a sale, do whatever. Most of the IFAs are trying to explain to you what will work for your risk profile, your goals. So it's a lot of the investor's interest, which is now in mind. So look at the data look at what it's telling us, that when you hard code consumer protection into a financial product, investors understand and they come and buy the product. So Mr. Bhave does this, and then after that there was a few years of very little reform, or we went back a bit in the interim between Mr. Bhave and Mr. Tyagi. And what happened in that period is that so now there is no load, but there is a trail commission, and industry is very, very smart. They began to upfront the trail to say that instead of giving it to you at the end of the first year or the second year, we will give it to you at the beginning of the year. So upfronting of 1% started, all right? So that instead of at the end of the 1 year, I'll give it to you when you sell. It's still a front load. And then the game always gets bigger and bigger. Then there were distributors, large distributors, who said, our SIP book is very good. I'm promising you an SIP of 3 years. You have 5 years. What you do is you give me the trail commission for these 5 years now. So that upfronting of between 4 to 6% began again. Then, so again, around that time, around 2011-12, there was an incentive given to take mutual funds beyond the top 30 cities, and the incentive, the load came back through that door. And again, the industry began to round trip investor money, large ticket investor money through from Mumbai. It could be registered in Thane, for instance. And then that commission could be harvested. Direct plans were introduced so that savvy investors didn't need an agent, could go to the fund itself and would pay that trail commission, would also not be there. Mutual funds didn't even reduce commissions. So the commissions for both, the expense ratios for both direct and regular were similar. Industry began, you know, there's a practice called inter-scheme transfers. They would do that so that the flagship schemes would do well, and they would stuff bad paper and stock into schemes which are not flagship or were not, large investors were not invested in them. And worst of all, schemes were not true to label. So you had balanced funds, which when you say balanced fund, which means balance between equity and debt, you would see star fund managers giving excellent returns in balanced funds, but they forgot to tell the investor that there was a large part of the money in mid-cap stocks. Now, it is a conservative equity investor who goes to a balanced fund. So to put that investor's money into mid-cap funds, however smart the fund manager is it's a violation of the investor trust. So then what happens is, you have 2017, Ajay Tyagi takes over. And with him comes a new team. There is Mr. Mahalingam, there's Madhi Puribuj, and there is a SEBI that personally I have never seen before, who is working in investor interest and taking it to another level. And the view of this SEBI is that they've broken the market into three parts. Mutual funds is for the basic retail investor. The person who really doesn't know much has to be very tightly protected. The HNI investor goes to PMS. Rules are less strict. There's far more elbow room to freedom there. And then for the very HNI, there are alternate investment funds, the AIFs. But for the retail investor, SEBI's view is that we will very tightly regulate this market because this is an investor which needs to be protected. And you can say that it is micromanaging, but from the data that I have seen, and I have served on the Mutual Fund Advisory Committee for now more than 10 years, when you see the evidence, it is only a few fund houses who break the rules with great arrogance and confidence that they cannot be touched. But unfortunately, the rules then have to be changed for all of the funds. So what Mr. Tyagi and his team have done is that all upfronting is now stopped. There cannot be any upfronting of any commission. They have also broken the market into an advisor and a distributor. So either you're an agent and the AMC pays you a trail commission or whatever other compensation you work out. But if you're an advisor, you have to be registered with SEBI. You can take no money from the asset management company, either directly or indirectly. You will have to get the investor to pay you a fee. Just as we pay fees to lawyers and doctors, a financial advisor is equally, if not more, important. And the investor will annually pay a fee according to either the AUM or whatever amount you discuss with the planner. Expense ratios have been reduced. This was a big fight because the expense ratios which worked in the industry was of a certain size. And now when it is 31 trillion, expense ratios should have come down. Again, data showed us that instead of bringing the expense ratio down and benefiting investors, that extra money was going to distributors through the back door. So SEBI put a stop on that, and then expense ratios for the entire industry got reduced. The schemes got better categorized, and every fund house was allowed one scheme in the every category. So now there are 32 categories, and every fund house can only have one scheme in that category, because why do you need three schemes in a particular category? It was really confusing investors. So then how do you mark out risk? The riskometer that SEBI has introduced in Jan is it's a third generation riskometer, which is embedding a lot of market information into the metrics of risk and return for both equity and debt. We'll see how this works, but according to me, if a risk-averse investor wants to buy a debt fund and picks a low-risk debt fund on the riskometer, his risk genuinely is going to be very low, right? So we've got excellent things like trying to label the schemes properly, making them true to label, putting the riskometer in place, the advisor distributor, the differentiation, benchmarks are now being defined better, inter-scheme transfers are being stopped. So a whole lot of under the bonnet changes have happened, which then make the product a far safer a place to be. You will always have a blowout like a Franklin Templeton case. There'll always be stories like that. But it's like having road rules. Does your traffic system prevent most of the accidents? And yes, but there'll always be a joker in a BMW who will jump the red line. What do you do with that? You know, so should you tarnish the entire traffic system because of one failure? Or should you say that, well, 90% of the time it works well. There was a problem there and we are trying to sort that. I think we should take that view that it works well. There are problem areas. It isn't as if the entire thing is a problem area and most people get cheated. Some people have a bad outcome. Most of the people do well. And I've actually spoken for longer than I wanted on the history, but it is so interesting to, you know, give you the whole view and tell you why I think mutual funds actually work for the investor, because you had 15 years of regulatory action on them. So you have a product structure which works for investors. You can compare funds through the in a category, you can compare them. They're true to label mostly. Rules of the games are clear. Regulator is vigilant. And the industry has made innovations with SIP, STP, SWP. I'm sure you know these terms if you don't just Google. And again, I love to show this chart that this was the market. The red line was the market over 40 years. And this is what happens to markets when the market senses reform, when the market senses growth ahead. And one of the best ways to invest in equity, of course, investing in debt is also very important, is through mutual funds for a lot of reasons that I have spoken about. Direct stocks are risky. Day trading is fun. It's not investment. Most investors should start with index funds, and then you can get that growth of equity. And I'm going to actually just skip out to how do you use mutual funds? I'll just speak for another 5 minutes and we can take questions. So all this theoretical knowledge is great, but the minute you come to the market, it's difficult because there's so much to choose from. investors tend to choose according to return. See, but that is last year's return. You have to flip it and choose according to need. And since all of you are students of personal finance, you may have read the book, Let's Talk Money. The way to do it would be to identify each box that I've spoken about, see what you need there, and then use mutual funds to finance those needs. So the first step would be to choose a category. For instance, this first cell, we're trying to do our cash flow as well, right? So you have three bank accounts, and some of the people who can understand liquid funds prefer to keep the, even their spending money in a liquid fund, right? So we are still a little far away from on tap use of this money, but it takes one working day for the money to drop into your savings bank account from a liquid fund. So you have to see what works for you. In emergency fund, you can use liquid funds. You choose the growth option, choose direct, go direct, and this should be low on the riskometer. So your use of funds really starts from the emergency fund. If you don't understand funds, you can still use fixed deposit, but liquid funds are very powerful products to use on both tax and return. Now, the third cell is the short-term goal. These are up to 3 years, and you don't want to take risk of equity on that. Conservative investors can choose liquid funds. You can even do short-term debt funds, short-duration funds. Go for the growth option, choose direct. It's still low risk on the riskometer. Okay, because dividend is not a good option. You don't want that money. You want it to grow. It's good for tax purposes. Go direct. So you save on the commissions as well. Now you're coming, now you're beginning to use equity. These goals are about 7 years away, between 3 to 7 years away. Now you can start choosing both conservative hybrid for goals which are closer, aggressive hybrids which are closer to 7 years, large cap, flexi cap, index funds. All of these are categories which can work for medium-term goals. Again, you're choosing growth, you're choosing direct, medium. Now you're taking medium to high risk on the riskometer, because a large cap will become high risk. Your long-term goals is where you start now diversifying into mid and small cap. Your riskometer will now show high to very high risk. And then retirement, of course, I have not talked about it, but it'll look very similar, where your riskometer will show high to very high risk. Because remember, your retirement fund, your safe money is in your PF, in your PPF. Your long-term retirement money has a portfolio of good equity funds. How do you choose a fund? You're looking at past performance, you're looking at consistency, you're looking at risk-adjusted return, you are looking at benchmark and category comparison, you're looking at a low expense ratio for index funds, you're looking at a low tracking error. All of these are, I think, chapters in themselves, but I encourage you to read a little bit about how to understand past performance, consistency, risk-adjusted return, and all of these. So essentially, these are retail-oriented products. You either need to learn yourself or go to a fee for a financial planner. It is also a space for enterprise, for people who want to set up their financial planning firms. And women are excellent financial planners, because money is, it's more than just money. A lot of emotions and a lot of soft skills are related to managing a household's money. So women make excellent planners. I can only encourage some of you who find interest in this to think about this even as a career. Thank you. I will just stop sharing and back to you, Dr. Prohit.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I think it was an unmatched orientation for the students on mutual funds, starting with the historical perspective and taking up all the critical elements. I think it's always a challenge when we have very less time, and the expectation is to cover all the things. I remember once Gandhi ji sent a letter to someone and said that I am writing a big letter in a hurry because I don't have have time to write a small letter. So when we have to tell the things in a crispy manner, I think a lot of preparations also go into it. And ma'am, you have prepared all these slides and all specially for our students. So our gratitude to you for that. Now I hand over to our student team for the questions that they have collected from the students. So ma'am, we have our BCom final year students who are studying these courses, Ms. Avni Sharma, Palak, Israni, Mansi, Ria, Payal and Muna, who have encouraged the students to enroll. And after that, they have also collected the questions and tried to take out those questions that were repeated. So it's over to you, Avni.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Namaste, ma'am. Namaste, sir. Today, me and my friends, along with this panel, want to interact with you with some questions. So, to begin with, I hand over to Palak. Palak, please proceed. Thank you.
Very good morning, ma'am. Ma'am, from the panel side, the first question goes like this. Can a mutual fund change the nature of scheme to one that is specified in the offer document?
It can only do so after getting permission from the trustees, and also it will have to notify SEBI. So there are rules around what the fund can. It cannot midway. So it's like saying that you have onboarded investors for a bus going to Noida. You can't midway take it to Gurgaon. Okay, you will need permission. So there's a whole host of rules to be followed. You can't midway say ki abhi large cap tha, now I do small cap. It can't happen.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am. The next question is, how can one track the performances of a particular mutual fund scheme?
I think there's a lot of data which funds give out. AMFI gives out, which is the industry association. Plus, you have third-party analysts like Value Research. You have Morningstar, and their websites are very rich with data, and it's free. So any investor who wants to say, look at the performance of XYZ, a small cap fund, if it just goes to the Value Research site and sees that fund, not only will you get information on that scheme, you'll also get comparisons with other funds in that category, with the benchmark, the expense ratio, the fund manager. So mutual funds as an industry gives out very rich data, and you have third parties who harness that data to make it available to retail investors.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am. My question is, can a non-resident Indian invest in mutual fund?
Yes, I think there are some rules. There are countries, I think Canada and US, there are some funds which have the permission to sell in those locations. But otherwise, you have to tick some regulatory boxes, but there is no, there is no prevention of NRIs from investing. You can definitely invest.
Thank you.
Good morning, ma'am. My question is, if in case the mutual fund scheme wind up, then what happens to the money we invested in it?
When a fund winds up, there's a whole lot of regulatory processes which have to be done. Remember, the money is not held by the AMC, it's held in trust. And the only place where the money can go is back to the investor according to the number of units you hold. So if a scheme is winding up and there are 20,000 crore of assets in that, that will be divided up pro rata according to the number of units you hold, and investors get their money, what they had invested and whatever returns there are. So there is nowhere else that money can go.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the answer,
ma'am. The next question is, from that we know that there's a wide belief that the mutual fund CFO should be the key factor for the selection of a scheme. Now, what is your opinion on this matter?
So CFO for the mutual fund will be a chief finance officer for the fund house. I think what we are thinking about is the fund manager. Fund manager is one of the attributes of a mutual fund in when you choose it, not the only, because it is not just about the return, it's also about the risk. So different fund houses will have different ways in which they think about risk, and they hard code risk, mitigating risks into the way that the fund manager behaves. So yes, fund manager is important, but that is not the only criteria. You also have to look at the stability of the return that that fund manager has given, especially when the markets go down. So it's very revealing to see a fund manager's performance when the Sensex or the Nifty drops by, say, 20%. How did that fund do when that happened? Did it drop by only 10% when the market dropped by 20? Or did it drop by 30? You know, so how well has risk been taken care of by the fund house?
Thank you so much for answering the question, ma'am.
Ma'am, the next question is the higher net worth of a sponsor guarantees the better returns?
No. Net worth of the sponsor has nothing to do with returns. The return is purely coming out of the way the fund manager is managing your money, the way that the mutual fund AMC is managing your money. The sponsor's net worth used to be important for giving money to distributors to help sell the product. So it was actually a deterrent for well-performing funds, because if the sponsor had a lot of money and they could pay for distribution, then even badly performing funds would get sold. So the only metric for investors is the mutual fund, its performance, its past performance, its risk metrics, its expense ratios. The sponsor is important to the extent of how it is perceived in the market. Are there good stories about the sponsor? There are some sponsors in the industry, and I won't take names, where there are not such good stories about those sponsors. And most distributors then stay away from them. Right? So there are some sort of smaller fund houses, they work in strange ways, but those names don't even come into the conversation of portfolios which most investors hold.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, the next question is, how should we judge the performance of our mutual funds and switch accordingly to the market's push and pull?
So my recommendation is that markets can go up and down. Your portfolio should not change according to the market. If you're choosing a set of 5 to 7 funds, those are the funds you stay with unless your life situation changes. Then you make a change in the funds. But if the funds are well chosen, then there's no need to change them. When the markets crashed by 30% last year, I remember telling everyone that if your asset allocation was good, if you had chosen good funds, do not exit from the market. And people who did not exit today are seeing almost 100% jump from the lows of 25,000 Sensex, it's 50,000. So if your funds are good, then no matter what happens, till your goal is reached, you don't redeem.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, my question is, how safe and credible are the various apps regarding mutual fund? Is it safe to invest in mutual fund through online mode?
You know what? This territory is still emerging, but when you download an app, you really need to be careful of what kind of data that you are giving to them. Is it SEBI registered? Is that interface, is that company, who are they? Remember, it's your money and you are creating a pipeline from your bank to somewhere. So I would be very careful to know who's the company behind the app, and are you a SEBI registered entity? who are you? So be a little careful with apps.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the answer.
Ma'am, the next question is, if supposedly I am sure about the performance of a particular commodity stock for the coming year 4 to 5, so what will be the better option for me to invest in? Invest in particular stocks which I know will rise in only in them, or invest in a commodity based on mutual fund schemes, or invest in a diversified equity fund?
I don't know who it is who knows that a stock will definitely go up. Even fund managers cannot say with this certainty that I know that in the next one year, this stock will go up. This can only be said in hindsight. So when you start today, do I know that the Sensex will end at 60,000 or 40,000 by the year end? I have no idea. So largely, the way that I look at investing is not return based over a year. It's more about my portfolio and how I want to target different goals. So I don't typically look at a return-based analytics of investing. Of course, returns are important. But if you start chasing return, you'll always buy last year's winner.
Okay, thank you so much,
ma'am. My next question is, are there sufficient researches to prove that a combination of SIP and SWP in a range mutual fund scheme is the best investment style for retirement planning?
So retirement planning will actually be SWP, because SIP happens when you are earning. So that's a great way to gather a corpus. So if your question is SIP when you're earning and SWP when you've retired, yes, it's a fantastic combination. The only thing you need to remember with SWP is your rate of withdrawal should be less than the rate of growth of the fund. So if you're withdrawing 6% and your fund is, your rate of return is about 5%, then you're drawing down capital. So you have to remember to harvest only that much so that you're not dipping into the capital. If you plan to if you want to preserve the capital, your withdrawal rate has to be lower than the growth rate. And I'll have time for maybe 2-3 questions more. I need to leave by about 12:10.
We can have the last question.
Okay, no, we can do a couple more, no problem.
Ji. Okay.
My next question is, how does the SEBI ensure that a gold ETF has really bought gold against the money raised by it?
So there are very strict rules on where you can buy the gold from and where it is to be stored. And SEBI has a vigilance department which can call for evidence and information. And it would be a very brave fund house to not buy the gold, because you will never operate in financial markets in India if you're caught to be not buying the gold that you're supposed to buy. So your entire career is finished. If an episode like this happens, I don't think anybody can ever dare to do something like that. So if there is a gold ETF, there is gold being bought.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. My next question is, when the market is crashing, which category of mutual fund should we invest in?
When the market is crashing, your only hope is that your asset allocation has been good. You have chosen good funds and there is nothing that you do. You do absolutely nothing when markets either crash or rise. When markets crash and you find that your asset allocation has changed, it'll be that you are less invested in equity. That is the time to actually redeem your debt part of it and invest in equity. When markets are rising so much, your asset allocation has changed. That is the time to sell part of the equity and invest in debt. So you always do counter to what the market is doing. But for that, your foundation has to be very solid, that you've understood your asset allocation and you are prepared to stick with that when markets are either rising or falling.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
So I trust there may be even a lot more questions, but maybe we can take those questions next time we get an opportunity to interact with them.
Definitely.
But just before the students convey the vote of thanks, my colleague Dr. Pavandeep ji is also here, and I think she mentioned last time the benefit she had when she was just about to go for redemption in the mutual fund when the market was about to crash, and she remembered the learning from Mudita ji, and then she didn't go for it. So Pavandeep ji, any thoughts?
Namaskar ma'am.
Namaskar.
Namaskar, namaskar students, and really it's always when I have this, because I can see that really I'm a die-hard fan of ma'am, and most of our MBA students are also here, because whenever I share with them that it's a webinar by Monica ma'am, and there's a lot of feedback, like eagerly looking forward, we'll join, when it will start, lots and lots of questions. So I hope like this legacy goes on and on. And on the occasion of Women Day, like on 8th of March, ma'am, PTM had shared a video where, you know, some questions are asked where the ladies were there, boys and girls, they are the questions, and the first that regular question, saving, spending, like if the answer is yes, you'll have to step forward, and if the answer is no, you'll have to step the backward. And at the end, what we watch, most of the women, you know, they are behind men. So here the Paytm wants to give a message that financial literacy, financial independence is very important for a woman, because again and again their focus is if you educate financially a woman, your whole, you know, the whole family is educated. And really we are thankful to you that because of you, you are educating all of us, like all our students, girls. And I have also already read half of the book of Baat Paise Ki, you know, in the Hindi medium also, because I've told you that I was the first one to get that book. And luckily it's in our library, and then I have start reading that also. And really we are fortunate enough, ma'am, to have your presence, and eagerly looking forward for you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And I've seen the Paytm ad, and every student of Banasthali has to be at the front of that line. That is my wish, and that is my blessing, that all of you will be in the front of that line.
That's so, so nice.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you
so much. Dear students, please convey the vote of thanks.
Sure, sir. Namaste, ma'am. Namaste, sir. On behalf of FMS Wisdom Banasthali, I, Avni Sharma, take this moment to extend my heartfelt gratitude to the chief speaker of this national webinar, Ms. Monica Hallan, ma'am. Ma'am, we have always been referred to you and your works in columns of Mint, and especially your book, Let's Talk Money, for our subjects of banking and personal finance by your professors, Dean Sir and Pavandeep Ma'am. And undoubtedly, we believe that your book is indeed a revolution in field of finance. Hence, we have been looking up to you on platforms like Twitter and LinkedIn too. So we really like to thank you for being so warm and approachable for Banasthalites via such platforms. Also, we would like to thank Dean Sir for making it possible for us to connect with you, ma'am. At last, but not the least, I would really like to thank my friends who are my fellow panelists today for their untiring efforts to make this learning session a successful one. Thank you everyone for joining in today.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And also thank our team from AIC Banasthali, Dr. Latika Duriya, who has also helped us in ensuring that technically the things go well.
Very well. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. And do well. We will definitely connect again. Thank you. Bye, Pawan.
And really, it's always an honor to see you. Thank you.
So dear students, wonderful program, and thanks for being attentive. And we will put the entire recording on YouTube very shortly. So if you have missed something, then you can see that. Okay, good. And I think the student team in the supervision of Pavandeep Ji, Dr. Latika Ji have done very well. Keep progressing, keep doing well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Well coordinated, everyone. Proud of you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
And thank you, everybody else, for joining in.